yourself, you cannot be my disciple. This year will be a year of holiness in Jesus' name. In holiness and righteousness before Him, how long? All the days of our life. That's the better promise the Lord has given us. We're going to endure it. We're going to demonstrate it. We're going to live in it. And nobody is going to beat us out of it in Jesus' name. In 2 Peter chapter 1. 2 Peter chapter 1. The better promises and the new covenant. 2 Peter chapter 1. I'm reading from verse 8. According as His divine power has given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of Him that has called us to watch, to this grace, to watch, to glory, and to vice, villainy, watch, virtue. It wants us to be virtuous. The wife at home must be virtuous. Our daughters must be virtuous. Our sons must be virtuous. There must be virtue in our lives. Our mentor, virtue flowing from our lives to other people every time. In verse 4, whereby are given unto us exceedingly great and precious promises, that by these exceeding great and precious promises ye might be partakers of what nature? Of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption. We're going to escape the corruption. I said we escape the corruption. You know, everybody is crying. Even the sinners are crying. They say there's too much corruption in this country. Corruption in the office. Corruption in the school. Corruption of examination malpractice. Corruption almost everywhere. But every one of us saved by grace, sanctified by faith, filled with the Holy Ghost, as we walk our lives this year, any office, anywhere we find ourselves, we're going to escape that corruption in Jesus' name. We will not talk like them, or live like them, or steal like them, or embezzle like them, or be immoral like them, or be soiled by the dirt and the defilement of this world like them. Saved and sanctified and set apart from the corruption that is in the world through laws. It is ours in Jesus' name. And this promise we're going to live in the enjoyment and the benefit of these better promises. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 6, a reading from verse 12. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 12. That ye be not slothful. Slothful in prayer? No. That ye be not slothful. Slothful in reading the Bible? No. That ye should not be slothful in morning devotion, family devotion, you'll not be slothful. That you'll not be slothful in soul winning, you'll not be slothful in the things, spiritual things the Lord is calling you to this year. That ye be not slothful, but followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promises. Inherit the promises. Anybody going to inherit promises here this year? You will in Jesus' name. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 10 verse 19. Hebrews chapter 10 verse 19. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus has been shed for us. And the blood of Jesus has been shed for us. That blood is to make us enter boldly. Not timidly, not as if maybe I don't know whether the Lord will receive me or not, whether He'll grant me the privilege or not, whether His grace is going to shine upon me or not, but we'll come before the Lord. And it says we enter boldly into the holiest, into the holy of holies, by a new and living way, which He has consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, His flesh. And having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with what kind of heart? A true heart. A true heart. Let's leave all the deception behind. Let's leave all the hypocrisy behind. Let's leave all the hide and seek of the past years. Let's leave all that there. Let's live a transparent life this year. A life that everybody can see through. A life that what you say is what you mean. What you mean is what you say. A life that in the private, in the public, is all the same. And then you're living in that glory of the Lord and that light of the gospel shining out of your life with a true heart. And then it says in full assurance. not partial assurance, in full assurance. In fact, isn't that faith? Faith is F-A-I-T-H. What does that mean? Full assurance in a trusting hearts. That's how to live this year. You are trusting the Lord. And because you trust the Lord and you have confidence in the Lord with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind, there is that full assurance in trusting hearts. And then it says, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience, our bodies washed with pure water, let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is what? Faithful that promise. He has given us these great promises, and he's a faithful God, and because he is faithful, that's why we're trusting him with full assurance, following after the Lord. Verse 35, cast not away, therefore, your confidence, which has great reward of great recompense of reward. For ye have need of patience, that after ye have done the will of God, what will happen? Ye might receive the promise. After ye have done the will of God, this year we commit this year to do the will of God. Will of God in everything. Young people, bachelors in particular, they're only thinking about will of God in marriage. Will of God, yes, in marriage, but his brother is greater than that. Will of God as you go to work. What I'm selling, is this the will of God to sell tobacco? No. Will of God, is this the will of God for me to sell alcohol? No. Will of God, is this the will of God for me to smoke marijuana? No. Will of God, is this the will of God for me to join business with unbelievers? He's serving the devil, I'm serving God. Is it the will of God for us to be together? No. The Lord is telling us that this year, after we have done the will of God, we're going to inherit the promises in Jesus' name. You wake up in the morning, your prayer is, a Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy will be done on earth as it is well done in heaven. This year we're committing ourselves to doing the will of God in everything and every time and everywhere. And it says, after you have done the will of God, it's only then we're going to inherit the promises. You have inherited the promise in Jesus' name. For yet a little while, and he that shall come will come, and will not tarry. Now the just shall live, how? By faith. But if any man draw back, anybody going to backslide this year? Going to draw back this year? Not going to be there that you are not found in your place this year? Anybody there? No. It says, if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. But we are not of them who draw back unto perdition. I will not draw back. I said I will not draw back. We are not of them that draw back unto perdition, but of them that believe to the saving of the soul. 2 Corinthians chapter 7 verse 1. We have the better promises. What's to be our response? Since we have the better promises, the greater promises, what should be your response? The Lord has favored you, and he says, I'm lifting you higher, I'm moving you forward, I'm giving you promises that are better than any promise of those Old Testament people, patriarchs or prophets. Let's look at 2 Corinthians chapter 7 verse 1. Having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness. Out of gratitude to God, out of appreciation of the better promises the Lord has given us, the promise to save, the promise to heal, the promise to strengthen, the promise to supply, the promise to sanctify, the promise to saturate us with the Holy Ghost, and the promise to answer all our prayers, the promise that you decree, seal, and shall be established. Having all these great promises, dearly beloved, in appreciation of what the Lord has promised that is going to do for us, in us, and through us this year, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and of the spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. We'll do that in Jesus' name. I come to point number 2, and it is blessed, or it is blameless purity and renewed consecration. Blameless purity and renewed consecration. You know, the Lord wants our lives to be above reproach. That is, when you look at your own self, your conscience will not reproach you. Your conscience will say, but you say you're a Christian. But we live a blameless life. That your conscience will say, praise the Lord, this year things are much better than previous years. That your mind will not reproach you. You'll be able to say, praise the Lord, is giving you victory in the private and in the public. That your mind will affirm the very fact that this year is the better, is the best year of any life you've ever lived since you were born into this world. Blameless, blameless purity. And renewed consecration in Philippians chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 15. Philippians chapter 2, verse 15. That she may be blameless and harmless. And you know what, brothers and sisters? Your conscience is the most powerful policeman that follows you about. And you'll feel weak when your conscience is saying, you've started again. You've done that again. And even though people don't know, your conscience following you about is blaming you every time, saying, when are you going to get out of this? When are you going to be free from this? When are you going to have the victory? And when a man's conscience is blaming him every time, he'll be a kind of a wicked man, a defeated man. He'll be a captive of the devil. If you want to pray, your conscience will say, you want to pray. But see the way you're living and see what you're doing. But when you come clear, when you come clean, and you're washed in the blood of the Lamb, and in the private, in the public, when you're alone, when you're with other people, your conscience cannot reproach you, because by the grace of God, you are washed, you are cleansed, and your life is holy and righteous. A blameless life, a harmless life will make you strong. In fact, the Bible says the righteous is as bold as a lion, but the sinner runneth when no man is pursuing. Holiness makes you bold. Blamelessness makes you bold. Righteousness makes you bold. And then will be the fulfillment of the promises of God in our lives that will happen this year. That she may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God, without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation, among whom ye shine as lights in the world. You know, there are some people, they kind of rejoice in having blame or reproach or rebuke. And you know, sometimes I hear from some of our people, they'll go to their coordinator, they say, coordinator, I've done this, and maybe you should discipline me. You are the one, you committed a crime, and you are the one that say, you are rejoicing in that crime. And you say, I want to be disciplined, I want to be rebuked. But it says, our life should be without rebuke, without discipline. I see you are rejoicing. You know, 19 such and such, I was disciplined. That's good testimony. And then 2002, I was disciplined. And last year, I was disciplined. And then I'm expecting another one this year again. I'm not expecting rebuke. I'm expecting recommendation. I'm expecting a life of joy, a life of happiness, a life when God will say, here is my beloved son, my beloved child, in whom I am well pleased. You know, there are people that want to collect discipline from group coordinator, collect discipline from coordinator, collect discipline from the pastor, collect discipline everywhere. And the only thing they collect is discipline. But me, I'm going to collect blessing. A life that is blameless, a life that is not rejoicing in discipline me, rebuke me, chastise me. That's not what we're looking for this year. We're looking for a life of righteousness without rebuke. And among the crooked and perverse nation, among whom you shine as lights in the world, holding forth the word of life, that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain, neither labored in vain. Blameless purity. God will purify us. Titus chapter 2. Titus chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 14. Who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from how many iniquities? All iniquity. And purify appealing for himself a peculiar people zealous of good works. Purify unto himself. That's what the Lord wants to do. He delights in purity. He delights in blamelessness. He delights in spotlessness. He wants to purify unto himself a peculiar people, precious people who are zealous of good works. We're looking at 1 Timothy chapter 5. 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 22. 1 Timothy chapter 5 verse 22. Lay hands suddenly on no man. Lay hands suddenly on no man. And that's the message to our overseers. Timothy was an overseer. That's a message to our pastors. Timothy was a pastor. That's a message to our leaders. Timothy was a leader. You know, sometimes because we want to grow, want to expand, want to have this and have that, we say, oh, you come, say this, you come and do this, you come and do this. And we lay hands on them and appoint them. You are not such and such, you are not such and such, you are not such. Lay hands suddenly on no man. Watch their lives and see whether their emphasis, the emphasis of their lives, is the emphasis for us this new year. Emphasis on holiness, emphasis on sanctification, emphasis on purity of heart, emphasis on living the life that is rapturable. Before you lay hands on anyone, lay hands suddenly on no man. You know, there are people, they want their workers to be in thousands and thousands, and they just bring in every Dick and Harry. Lay hands suddenly on no man. Oh, we have a need here, we have a need here, we have a need here. Then the needs remain until we find people who are appointed by God and people who are restored by God. Because it's saying over here in verse 22, lay hands suddenly on no man. Neither be thou partakers of other men's sins. Don't be partaker of other people's sins. If anybody wants to sin, let him be like an isolated man that, you know, everybody forsakes and say, at this year of holiness, at this year of purity and sanctification, you want to sin, you are by yourself, I will not be part of it. I said I will not be part of it. Be not partakers of other men's sins. You know, some of us who are, you know, living in these houses, face me, I face you. You understand what I mean? And then, you know, about three people living inside the same room, that's okay. But this year, God will promote you. Yeah. And God is going to provide. And you're going to have another place all alone by yourself in Jesus' name. Yeah.